Let us go ahead and get ourselves started with session 7. I apologize for starting late today. Actually, I'm not learning much today. Very confusing. Wow, sorry that time. We will jump right in respect for the time and how late I'm starting today. In terms of what we're going to do today, we want to talk some about actually neuroscience and what's going on with some of the things that you've done. Just to briefly recap what we've been looking at, because we're going to sort of pick up on that same thread. We were looking at just the whole notion of putting panels on top of different surfaces, dividing into panels and putting panels on the surfaces. And we had started diving into the example of creating a parametric stadium as a kind of inspiration for some of the things you might be doing. In terms of assignment one, I actually want to talk with you about what you are doing on your assignment one, what you're thinking about it, and just do a little bit of strategizing about your projects and how you might be approaching them. Because we've sort of been talking to several people about that in office hours, off and on, and I think there's some kind of common ways to approach it that might be good to share. Today, what we'd like to do, just in terms of giving you some more to work with, is continue going with this example of the parametric stadium, okay, because a lot of what's going on in that is a kind of similar probably to strategies you'll be using, where it all starts with defining some initial geometry using Giordano, then going through and subdividing that geometry by placing points and then grouping the points either to create ribs or trusses or some sort of beams to support something, and then ultimately going through putting some sort of panels across the surface of the whole thing. So there's some kind of commonality to like what you can do there. We'll go ahead and kind of walk through that, but we'll also go through, and I want to talk to you a little about how you can start selectively altering the elements, because we've been going through and just taking a bunch of different elements, a bunch of panels that we're putting on, or ribs that we're putting on, by grouping a bunch of points and just doing the same thing to everything. You know, haven't really been making much of a distinction to it. Where if we start subdividing things a little bit, we can actually start creating sort of more interesting things. Things where, oh, every other rib or every third rib is something of a special panel. And where you start thinking about creating panels or even subdividing them into behaviors, there's a couple of new constructs we'll sort of talk about today. Get out of an index you're sort of used to. That's kind of, you know, we're just going to go through and grab every first, every second, or every, if we feed the get out of an index a pattern, you say get 0, 3, 6, and 9, you're grabbing every third element. Okay, and then we can do something special to that to kind of start making a pattern. Boolean masking is another great thing that we can sort of start playing with. The whole notion there is for every element, we can evaluate something about it. And based upon whether it's true or false, it's either going to fall into the in bucket or the out bucket. And depending upon which bucket you fell into, different things can happen. Okay, so we do a lot of Boolean masking, which is really just to evaluate everything relative to some criteria, true or false. Okay, and then at F bucket. Okay, but before we dive into all that parametric stadium stuff, let's talk about your examples and really what you're doing with your projects. So I met with a couple people and have been talking about some different strategies. I don't know, let's just kind of survey the group in terms of what's going on, because I know a little about what Dominique's working on and I know what you're working on, and they're very, very similar, okay, in terms of basic constructs. We can talk about that a little bit, or let me just kind of poll what other people are sort of doing in terms of have you gotten started, or what are you thinking about doing. We'll think of come up with a strategy and some commonality for the whole thing. So, Mike, what are you working on? Like, go ahead and give us a sense of it.
I have some sketches right here.
Oh, cool.
It's inspired by the shape of a pie crust. Uh-huh. So the outside, it's a circular canopy for a park, I imagine, and maybe a tree in the center. So the center has a hole in it, and the outside would have a sine wave undulating, and the smaller one would have a matching sine wave.
Cool.
And then I'm trying to work out how the structure would actually hold it in place. So I could imagine some beams along each of the like curves.
Mm-hmm.
Each of the curves could be a panel. Coming into, so the beams might come into a circular I don't actually know what's in it that I could just pop in, but let's kind of figure out.
It's all. Let me go for just a couple different examples to kind of get you started. Actually, I'll draw them on the screen over here because it might be a little bit easier for people to see. Otherwise, although my drawing accuracy is much, much less. Okay. One strategy, let me go for sort of what you two are both working on, which is really sort of more, I'll either call it a linear or an arced piece of geometry that's somehow undulating or changing, and then we'll go to circular. Okay, with the pie form, something like that. Okay, so in the kind of linear sort of strategy or the arcing strategy, what you often do is, let me just go and think about this in terms of defining some points. So if I have some x points and I have some z points, kind of hanging around here, super. What I want to do is start thinking about a shape that I'm going to go through and kind of extrude or undulate, do something. And a shape could look like this in one case. The shape actually, it might be a little more complicated to do something like that. Just a shape that we're going to be working with. It all starts with the whole notion of just going through and defining some points that are going to articulate and just really help us shape that curve. So the number of points you might need kind of varies. It just kind of depends on really how kind of compound your curves are. You probably need that point and need that point. But the number of points you need to go through and define the shape of that curve really just depends on like, how tight the curve is. I might want one there. I might want one there. I might need one there too. It just sort of depends on if we're going to do a smooth curve through those points, just how closely we can get that. Okay, so let's think about this. If I have something like this, which is basically placed using five different points, okay, we are going to create a couple different things. We have a basic geometry here, so in that geometry, we're going to go ahead and define where those points are, just using point by coordinate, and it might be, if this is x and that's the z, I can sort of locate them that way. Then we'll think about what we want to do with those points in terms of extruding this shape back. So as we think about this, if this were a linear form, okay, what you can start thinking about then is, great, if the y-axis was coming back like this, what you want to do is say that, okay, great, I've defined a bunch of points, I have this sort of y vector, and for each of these different points, I really just want to go through and figure out where the other end point is. Okay, so where those points are. Now the cool thing is, if you define the length sort of extruding into the board as being a parameter or slider or something like that, and you say this is y0, that could be y, whatever the slider value is. And really, you can use the same point definitions and just sort of give them all the same y. And then it's really just a straight line connecting the front to the back. Super. So if you have straight lines connecting the front to the back, you are all set to go through and say, great, I'm going to go through and put some intermediate points. I'm going to go through and divide this thing in terms of putting points at parameters by some sort of sequence. And I'll do it to all five of the different lines so they all have the same five curves. Same thing here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then I can start joining those together. If I have five different lines and five different sets of points along those curves, if I transpose, okay, I'll go from the 5 points going back into the board, more into you. Kind of five hoops that do that. Okay. And if I have those, super, I got a bunch of different curves. Those 5-point curves can be used for placing elements. Okay, we could also subdivide those 5-point curves
into more points to go ahead and create panel points. And that's what we'll do to the pumpkin-shaped stadium today. It's going to be something like that. Now, in this case, I'm showing it just doing it as straight lines going back. If I was thinking instead about doing something more radial, or something like that, not to worry. I just need to think about it a little bit different. If I have some sort of center point, you're always going to be defining some sort of center point. What you're going to think about each of these different points is doing is being a point on an arc that goes around the radius. Okay, so in that case instead, yeah, it's going to be a big arc that's going to go around the radius. But it's going to have, around the center point, it's going to have the same radius, it's going to have the same height. But once you get these arcs going around, it's essentially the same operation. You take an arc and subdivide it and grab those points, and you can sort of go through, you know, have whatever you want. Okay. If we wanted to be a little flexier, we could think about replacing some of these straight lines with sine waves or things that have a little more curvature to them. And that's not too bad. That's actually pretty easy to do because given a line, it's pretty easy to swap out an individual line with a sine curve. It'll go through and replace it. Okay. The big thing is, even after you define the sine curve, though, I'm going to sort of redraw this a little bit here. If this was my straight line representation, and I have my five different points for placing my ribs, okay, and I'm going to instead replace it with a sine wave, no worries. I basically take the same x values, I do some sort of transform to them to kind of get the sine wave, and I end up with, oh, something that looks, you know, more like this. Whatever's going on. After we go ahead and place that sine wave there, we're going to do the same thing. We're going to point at parameter to grab those points instead. Okay, so that's why point at parameter is so useful. It doesn't matter whether it's a straight line or a very curvy line, it'll break it into the same equivalent distances so that, you know, if I replace the blue line with a turquoise line as my end points, now the ends of my trusses or the ends of my ribs are waving. But for you, it's the ends of your pie crust are kind of following some of that. Yeah, I got it.
Yeah. Yeah, would you recommend starting with straight line? Because I was having a lot of trouble with curves.
Yeah. I'll always keep it simple first. So start with straight lines and then replace one of the straight lines with more of the sine wave. Same thing for you, Glenn. It's like, go ahead, we'll start with sort of a radius and then we'll say, okay, let's diff that radius. We'll create some sort of curving thing that'll replace that arc with sort of a arc that sort of has the up and down.
So it'd be like a radius with a radius, or a circle with a circle and then radial points as well.
Mm-hmm. Because you want to do that, yeah. We'll draw yours in just a second, because it's actually a really cool thing. Okay, yes?
I found that using that strategy, creating the points, the mm-hmm. curve that's created doesn't always hit all of the points.
Mm-hmm.
It sometimes misses them, and I was wondering if there's like a common cause for that?
Oh, it's really always, there's these different curve functions, and we have to watch out for what it is. There's a whole NURBS curve, and there's two variations of it. One that goes through the points, and one that uses the points as control points. So they're kind of like the points you push and pull on, but the curve won't necessarily go through it.
I see.
And then even in the pumpkin thing, there's kind of curve by points versus NURBS curve by points. There's different ones where you either, you know, some functions say draw it directly through the points, other they're just control points around the corners of the curve.
Okay.
For deflecting it. So you have to watch out for which function.
Okay.
Because even like when we were doing it with Dom, it's like the curve sort of followed the points, but it wasn't necessarily a great fit. Whereas if you do the one where it goes through those points directly, it'll go through as opposed to just trying to approximate the curve.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's like a dynamo, but when you put it into Revit, it works a little.
Well, because that's going to get into the placement points. The NURBS curve that I draw in here is really just to sort of visualize, approximate it. It's kind of to come close. But when I actually divide this curve into like five placement points or whatever it is that you know, is part of the element that's being put in here, that will, like adaptive components will deform and go right through those points. Okay, so there is this difference. Sometimes the geometry that's showing up in Dynamo doesn't exactly match. Okay, but it should be close.
Okay.
Sorry?
Yeah. So that was the difference between control points
and points. Exactly. Okay. It either goes right through or it goes through, it's kind of, the corners of the curve sounds funny, but it's really the definition lines that sort of are the tangents to the curves. Okay. So once we have this and we're in pretty good shape, that part next about creating a rib of some type is actually not too awfully bad. When Dom and I were doing it yesterday, we came up with a strategy that looks sort of like this. We went ahead and, if we wanted a 5-point something or other, you say, hey, I don't have a 5-point tube, I don't have a 6-point tube, or in your case, you may need a 20-point tube or something like that. Not to worry. What you can do is go ahead and, I'll go ahead and clear this out. Go through and in an adaptive generic, or generic adaptive part, okay, sort of one of these new tubes like we created in class the other day, go ahead and start by just putting a bunch of points all over the ground. Okay, make it sort of easy on yourself. Okay. So here I have 7 points in there. What I have to do is choose them all. And I'm going to say, great, make them adaptive. That'll put the little numbers on them. Okay. Then what you tend to do is you start by drawing a spline if you want a curvaceous surface. If you want a straight-legged segment, then you put lines between them. Okay, it kind of depends whether you want elbows or you want it to be smooth. But if you draw a spline and you draw a reference curve, and it's kind of important it's a reference curve, it likes to be a reference curve, through those, okay, you'll have basically a path to follow. And then what we can do is choose any individual one. And we can draw a profile around that. And then when we choose the reference curve, and we choose the profile and we extrude it, okay, it goes ahead and creates, yeah, that nice tube shape that goes all the way around. So what that's doing is it's creating a piece of form. In this case, it's a little round tube with 7 placement points. So in terms of what to work with, okay, you know, for the individual, when we get to your pie, you know, the spokes are probably pretty simple. They're only defined by 2 points, but for the outer ring, you can define it either as one long 20-point thing, or we can just sort of connect pair to pair. That would work too. We could go from point to point.
Right.
Okay, just kind of depends on how we define it. Doing the long one will be a smoother thing, because you won't get the joints at the middle.
Even I'll suggest, in the whole, that spiral example, there are some examples there to kind of play with. But let's go ahead and think about this. Okay, the pie is another very interesting example, so let's talk about that. Clara's got sort of a pie. The idea is more, we have a big old circle around the outside, and we have sort of an inner circle here. And along this pie, let's work on sort of the canopy part right now. Okay, if it's a nice perfect circle, it's great, we have that. We're gonna go through and just really define these as a starting point, just as arcs. So go ahead and get the radius, let them be flat. You got a radius there, you got a radius here. They'll both have a height, so you can sort of define them as flat line segments. Again, start simple. So if we want to divide this into 12 spokes or something like that, what we do is we have these two different curves and we do point at parameter to again start and just divide it into 12s. Actually, this is going to work out exactly, probably 16s. So place those points on the outside. Go there, point over here. Okay, so when you get all those points, you'll have two lists of points. You can work them in two ways. Again, start flat before we sort of flex it. If we go transposing from here to here, we'll get the ribs. Okay, so if you want some structural elements that go from the inside to the outside of the canopy, go ahead and grab like that. Grab like those two. Okay. This other side, though, if you want to go through and have the ring going around, again, there's two different strategies you might approach for that. There's a list here, and in the list, this is essentially item 0, and that's 1, and that's item 2, and that's point 3, and so on. Okay, so I can either go ahead and create a tube if I want something completely smooth. Know the number of points is going to be constant. You can create a tube that's 12 points long or something like that, and then place it along those 12 points. Just feed it the list in that order. It'll look for 12 points, and you give it 12 points. So that's one way of doing it. If the number of points is not necessarily going to be constant, because that's going to be something you're going to play around with, then we'll change strategies. We'll say, what I'm going to do is just going to create something that's going to go from here to here, and then I'll create something that'll go from here to here. So it'll go between pairs. And the way you do that, if you have basically a list, and it goes 0, 1, 2, 3, so this is a list of points. There's x and y values here. If I want the end point of this segment to be 1 and the end point of the next one to be 2, what I want to do is basically pair that with 1, pair that with 2, pair that with 3, pair that one with 4.
Is that list remain?
It's hip, yeah, exactly. It's the list remaining. So you take the 0, then you say list remaining. So what you do is you grab the first item, and you say list remaining, and you grab the second set. And what happens is if you say start to end, where the end is always list remaining, okay, it'll go through and pair first to second, second to third, third to fourth.
What happens at the end?
At the end, you actually end up with one bad one, right? Okay. So hanging around over here, great, you have 19s over here, then you have nothing over there, and 19s over there. Okay, so at that point, what's going on? Now, am I flipping it the other way?
Yeah.
It should be up.
Okay, it's that one. So what you gotta do is just take, you count the number of items in the list, so say list count. And you basically remove item at index, and you take out the last one.
You take out the 19.
Yeah, exactly.
So you just have to have a...
It will...
Is it 19 one of the points, though?
Actually, no, because it'll go from 18 to 19... Well, hang on, I got to think about this. It does close itself. I got to think about it. Or no, does it close it? Am I going to lose one that way?
It should close itself, right?
No, it won't. It'll lose the last one. How frustrating! What you gotta do is handle it basically special.
How do you add? Can you add something? Can you choose item 0 and then add it?
Exactly. Yeah, it's like add item at end or add item at index. So here's what you gotta do.
Is it list.shift indices, which shifts everything by some amount?
Does that exist?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. This is actually, okay, and will it rotate, will it fold back on itself at the tail end?
Yeah, so if I start with a list that goes like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I shift by 1, then it goes 2, 3, 4, 5, 1.
Ooh, I think. That would work.
Or maybe vice versa, but something
list
like that.
List indices?
List.shift indices.
List.
Sounds like is that one of the built-in functions? That sounds like a very useful one.
Yeah.
Okay, because in terms of, that's a good one. So, yeah. In general, we're messing with lists and we have things like this. Watch out for this. You'll do list count. List count will tell me there's 12 items, but watch out, because the index of the last item is actually list count minus 1. So always kind of play around with that. But
See if you can kind of get them to go pairwise. Then you only have to have like a 2-point thing go around there.
But I can change the number of points on the outside.
Yes. And so start by just getting it to look like a big flat pie. Okay. Then you say, oh, okay, I got something interesting here. Let's go ahead and see if I can, you know, get that thing to wave like a sine wave. Okay, and what you're going to get into is basically distances along the curve. Okay, so this is a curve. Well, no, take that back. It could be a lot of different things in terms of, well, no, you sort of want it to be a sine wave based on the distance along the curve, if you want it to kind of wave with that. Okay, so we'll dig in there and see if we can find the function that does that. But basically, you know that there's a certain distance all the way around there. Or in our case, if you want to think about the inner wave and the outer wave tracking with each other, you know, so that the waves, it's kind of a very tight wave and a very fat wave out there, kind of like a dual-wing cloth or something like that.
It might be that the sine wave has, can you define a sine wave with 2 points at the origin?
Oh, it will go negative, yeah.
So every time it crosses y at zero, crosses the x-axis, then there's a point there, right? That's how you define the points, and you place a sine curve along there. And then the...
Well, that's actually very clever to do it that way. Although, yeah, it's... Yeah, we got to think about just a mathematical... And I also drive it the other way, to basically say that... I got to think this through in my own mind about really how you want the math to do it. Because if you really want every spoke point to be the end of a wave, or something like that, you know, you almost want to subdivide the curve. Yeah, we got to sort of play with it so that you always end up basically, because you're sort of getting back into radians versus degrees or something like that.
Yeah.
We got to play with our sine function a little bit. So just basically convert those distances so that you basically are getting, let me put this over here. Right. If you want to make sure that it comes up and goes up and goes up so that every intersection point goes and do that. You need to sort of play with it a little bit. Actually, it's sort of interesting in here. You might be able to sort of force this now that I'm actually sort of thinking about it. Yeah, I got it.
Again, I have a question on the previous list from 0 to 19.
Yeah.
The second list should go from 1 to 20. It should have the same number of elements.
Well, no, if there were 19, if it was 0 to 19, the second one would go 1 to 19.
But 0 to 19 is 20, right? 20 list of points. It should
go
from 1 to 20, then.
No. It's basically just taking the tail end of your list from this point forward. So it's 1 to 19. The list remaining items is one element shorter.
Oh, I thought you were creating a new list.
Nah, it really just sort of gets the tail end of your list beyond you. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to suggest that actually there might be a way to do this that's sort of interesting. If you almost sort of think about really that being a unit length, kind of in there, where really...
Where maybe the frequency of the sine wave is how far away the points are.
Yep. Yeah, it's like, so basically, at this point, if you really thought of between here and here, if we thought of that as being 0 degrees and that being 360 degrees, and that distance always mapping there, you'll always get a perfect sine wave between the two. So what it is it's this whole thing about, oh, computing things relative versus kind of the global coordinate system. In a relative coordinate system, if you just thought of 2 to 3 being a piece of string, and it was going to follow the sine wave, you know, we can compute intermediate points between there, sort of using that function. So, yeah, a little deeper, well, we can talk about it, you know, like offline. We can go and dig into it through there. But if we think about, like, a lot of times as you're going through placing these things, as opposed to thinking about it in terms of a global coordinate system, it just makes the sense to think about it. Okay, you've divided your curve into all these different points, so now you really have that subsegment. Let me go ahead and put in a series of points along the curve between here to there. Because, you know, you're just doing points on a curve, so what is it?
At some point, yeah, first it's just a straight line. Like, think about if we just did it as a straight line. First I just put like 4 points on a curve. Then basically what I want to do is, if I want to have
like 4 intermediate points or 3 intermediate points between that, what I would then do is I have 15 points on a curve.
So again, like this. Okay, so then you have all those points. So really what we're trying to do is basically compute what the z value is for each of those different points. But really, what the z value is really, yeah, it's just based on trying to form that curve. Okay, so it's really just as though that's 0 and that's 1. So mathematically, as we go through and trying to do it, it's really almost like the every point that lines up here always has an apparent x value of 0.
Every point that's in the center always has an apparent x value of 180. Every one that's over here always has an apparent value of 90. So what you can kind of do is almost really form a pattern of points.
So if you have those 4 points, I have to create another set of points in between.
Yes. Yeah. So and we can create as many sets of points along the ring as we want to. So we can create these initial points that we've used for placing the kind of spikes. Okay, then we can create another set of points. You know, that really is the waves, the crimps in the pie crust around the edges. Okay, so what we got to do is basically find a way of saying, for this list of points, you know, what is it about the pattern that, you know, can let us go ahead and sort of really,
you know, what you want is for all these points, essentially, that one has to sort of be 0, that one in the middle has to be like 180. That's like 90. Yeah, that's like 270 in here or something like that. And back to 0 or whatever your rhythm is. So essentially, we're going to find some way of mathematically mapping that.
The frequency of the sine wave is going to end up being the degrees between.
The frequency will determine really how many ripples are happening between each spoke. So as we adjust the frequency, the ripples are going to get closer together or further out.
Which is between each point 0 to 1, that's like a certain degrees along the circle, right?
Yes.
So
It's a little bit of messing around. I'm waving my hands right now, but I think if we start digging into the math, we'll actually find a way of mathematically determining this along this. You know, if we divide it into points, you know, it relatively, you know, there's point 0, there's point 1, and there's just intermediate points along there. And we're just going to do some scaling, like, at everything. So if this were
0, and this is 0.5, and this is 0.25. Yeah. What you're going to do is basically convert those
sort of parameters, okay, into really an x value that you compute the sine wave on, really by multiplying something by it. So, you know, if you said that you wanted to have 12 ripples going through here, let's think about that. So let's say I want 12 ripples. You would be, you have complete ripples. You would need 12 times 360 degrees. Okay, so 0.5, the value there would be 0.5 times 12 times 360, because you really, you want, as you go all the way around the curve, it to be as though you went through 12 complete rotations around the curve to get the sine wave. So I think it's actually just, it's kind of going to be something like that. It's really just based on the total number, you know, and the frequency you put in there about how many ripples you are, you basically say that you have a certain number of degrees, okay, all together, and then you multiply kind of where you are on the curve. You're at the 0.1 curve times the total number of degrees. You get the degree value for that. You get the sine value, and that'll sort of, you know, basically mathematically give you the curve going. I think it'll be like that. Okay. Does that almost make sense, or?
Almost.
Almost, okay.
Okay, we will play. Any other like kind of examples that people want us to like tackle? Andrew, what you got?
Is there any way to take an existing either set of points or a curve and then move, say they're all at y equals 0, make them duplicated at, say, y equals 6?
This is interesting. So in were they mathematically defined, or how were they defined?
They're defined through a series of create points or point by coordinates. But the way I have this thing set up, if I try to do a cross product, it just makes a giant mess of points because I have some specific z values.
So you're trying to basically, you have the same x and z values, and you're trying to replace the y's.
Yes.
Okay. What would it, you know, because, okay, points have this notion of, you can say point dot x, point dot y, and point dot z. So if you fit a list of points, okay, into like three functions, point dot x and point dot z or something like that, and then you just plugged in a new value for y.
Okay, so then I could use those x's and z's and make.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then just, you know, so it'll get the correct list of x's, the correct list of z's, your new improved list of y's. Or we could take the y values out and transpose them, you know, y plus 10. Okay. And then recombine them back into point by coordinates.
Okay.
Okay, I think that'll work. Okay. So lots of, it all comes down to list management. It's weird list things you do. Okay. Any others? No? Okay. We will play. Now, just dig in and have some fun. Okay. Hopefully today we'll do with the little pumpkin will help us along that way. So let's then turn our attention to some of the things we're going to be talking about today. And the big thing is, back in this parametric stadium, I wanted to sort of look at, there's a lot of stuff going on in here, but it's really this overall kind of strategy that sort of mirrors a lot of the strategy we've been talking about. Starting by defining some just arcs, and then once we define some different arcs, placing some points along those arcs that can then be used for placing trusses or panels. And the important point is that you don't necessarily have the same rhythm. If I want trusses at every other point, or I want panels subdividing between the trusses, I can break them into different sets of points along the curves. You know, it just sort of depends on what we're trying to achieve. So where we started out last time, where I'll pick it up again with this time, was really we had defined some initial arcs. Okay, and then within those arcs, again, we went through and said, super, let's define some sort of number of trusses in a code block to kind of define a pattern of points. Say curve point at that parameter, and we'll feed it. Okay, a list of arcs and these parameter points, the cross product to put those on all the different arcs. Okay, and transpose, let us pull that out. So that's where we were. Actually, we'll dive into there, but even before we dive into there, let me go ahead and just go over to Revit and open up actually the tail end of this whole story. Because in the tail end, I sort of formatted it in a way that actually may be useful for you to kind of see like an overall logic. I'm going to go into Dynamo, and if you want to open up as a starting point, just 11b, this is like when you go to the last page of the novel and you figure out whether it really ended the way you wanted, so you can, you know, decide whether you want to bother reading it. If you're one of those people, look ahead and you'll get some examples of how this is all going to work. Let's see what I got going on here. Where's my dynamo? A little Navis works happening in the back. Oh, there's dynamo. Okay, let me say open. And what I'm going to do is in session 7, just go to 11B. This is actually sort of a very big graph, so what I'm trying to do more and more is just use these kind of color-coded groupings to help us understand what's going on. So let me just kind of walk you through my overall logic here. We sort of started down in the green zone, right in the center. Goodbye, Mr. Action Center. Where we define some different heights for some forward defining curves, some radii with a couple extra eyes in there. For the defining curves, we created some kind of center points of the arcs, and we created some arcs to pull them all together. And we even, because arcs can sort of be complete circles, or they can have start and end angles, depending upon what you prefer, and I put that parameter in there. So this middle part was all about defining those initial circles, those going around. In terms of my overall logic for this example, we start by creating those, but then, just in terms of where we're going today, to give you an overview, if you go down the graph a little bit, you'll see there's this whole notion of putting these trusses on there. And so what I tried to do is basically define some parameters for placing the trusses. I have an integer slider for the number of trusses. Okay, we have a family type that we're going to use. And what we're going to do is compute where the truss rib locations are by dividing the arcs up into 0 to 1 by the number of trusses. Okay. We're going to put some curve points at the parameter, then we're going to transpose it and basically grab that collection of points to put in the trusses. Okay, that's sort of where we left off last time. Okay, placing those adaptive points. My stadium, before I put some panels on the outside, we wanted to play around a little bit more with adaptive components, so we, in the stadium, have included some of these little guys, which I call risers. They're really just stairs at the bottom, or you can think of as seats. Those seats are really like a whole bunch of little adaptive components. It's a little 5-point adaptive component, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points. Kind of like a little L-shaped thing that will wrap around. So, you know, we're making these very kind of straightforward tubes, but they can actually be much more interesting than that too, in terms of adaptive components. So if I give it kind of a profile, I give it 5 points around an arc, it'll do its best to sort of wrap around and create that. So what we wanted to do just for kind of creating these stairs is go through and start by just defining the different radii. Okay, these different arcs that would be kind of the top of each step, then subdivide that into the same 5 points so that we can place 1 component, 2 component, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's where that next little chunk of logic is. And there's a lot of logic in that little chunk. It's, we define the seating parameters as the origin of where the seats start. There's the internal radius of the very first, the initial one, the height of each, the tread height of each, the number of risers. All of this math kind of in the yellow right here is all about just computing those different radiuses so that they sort of rise up a little and spread out a little bit. Okay. Then we say that we have a 5-point riser, and we basically go through and divide the riser in curves, or the riser arcs, into placement points. Then place it using those 5 points. So that's what the little bottom is. Okay. As we go through and place these things, we not only place the adaptive component, that part's good, but I also went through and adjusted the heights and the depths of the risers so it matched, because the adaptive component has parameters that let you set the size so it can have it match the slider. So we're back to setting parameters by name. That's a little preview of what's going on there. Okay, last but not least, if I've got trusses and I've got all those different risers in place, I come back up to the top. At the top, I went through and started placing the panels. There's no specific, you know, reason or order to this. It's kind of however it sort of lays out best for you. And by putting them in groups, it makes it a little bit easier to move things around. I have some panels placement parameters. I have the family type, basically the number of rows and the number of columns. And then what I did was first sort of create vertical curves, okay, you know, to be the vertical seams between the panels. And then I have the number of panel rows. So I basically, I could either divide the columns first and then the rows, or I could divide the rows first and make the columns. Either way. But either way, in the end, I'm going to basically create some different curves, subdivide it into more of a rectangular grid. And finally, just place some adaptive panels. Okay. And at some level, the high-level logic of this probably looks like the high-level logic of your project. And somehow, geometry, subdivide the geometry, group it way one, place a certain element based on that grouping, group it way two, and place, okay. So, hopefully that's sort of familiar. Okay, but does the overview kind of make sense? Beautiful. Okay, if that makes sense as an overview, let us go ahead and work through the example. Actually, for today, is it okay if we just kind of plow on through since I kind of got off to a late start? Okay. If you need to get up and bio break, please do. You know, whatever you need, but I want to get some more stuff out here for you. Great. Okay. So what I'll start with, let's go back out to, how about 2A? That's where we're defining the truss ribs. Again, the function we were doing here was really, we had some basic arcs we were going to go through and use an integer slider with a number of different points, kind of compute the points, and then basically put points at parameter and transpose it so we get the little NURBS curves. Again, this little NURBS curve over here is really just, well, what is it? It's a curve which is sort of joining those different points. But even here, let's look at the different options because there's different ways. There's by points, by control points, by, you got a lot of variations.
Has the one by points and it worked out.
Okay, because that actually goes through the actual points as opposed to by control points, which is where it grabs the stretchy points.
Right.
Okay, beautiful. So I'm coming on in here. Let me zoom on in. All the stuff up at the top we looked at last time. In terms of, being able to create these different arcs. So we have, again, it's just sort of my own definitions, and sometimes it takes a little fussing and playing to get the shape just the way you want it. But I have four different curves. I'm gonna have them all basically have the center point at 0, 0, but the heights will be determined by this first block, the radii will be determined by the second block, and by combining it into lists and feeding this thing basically a series of a list of four different center points and a list of four different radiuses, okay, it's happy. Since I am not feeding it a list for start and end angle, it'll use the same start and end angle parameters for all four of them. That last thing, let me kind of tell you about that. Vector z-axis, what's that all about? Just so you know, as you're going through and creating a lot of different things, there's this notion of basically which way is up as it's creating. And you'll see vector z-axis, what it's all about, that basically creates a vector which has 0, 0, and 1. So 1 in the z direction. So it's basically saying, as we're going through and creating these arcs, they're going to be radiating around, or they're going to rotate around basically an axis that points up. Okay, and we can change that. We can put another normal vector in there. If we want to do arcs that sort of radiate out sideways, we put a Y or an X, or really anything, and it'll go through and just sort of rotate those arcs around whatever that vector is. Okay. It can be very useful later on when we're trying to point things at the sun or point them at objects. Okay, but for right now, we're just kind of growing out of the ground.
Z-axis is the default.
What's that?
Is Z-axis the default?
No.
If I run it without connecting that node, it still rotates on the Z.
Just says vector. So I would guess that perhaps it does. It is, but I guarantee nothing. Let's see if I can figure it out. Normal vector, don't know. Interesting. I would guess that would be its default. But just so you know, there's also vector x, there should be a vector y, or we might compute a vector. Vector x, vector y, those are some little unit vectors. Okay. Once we have those arcs, we are ready to go through and start bringing them in terms of placing those points on them. So the points that we're going to place on them, again, very much like you will do, whether it's lines or arcs or whatever you're using, we have the number of kind of truss point parameters. This is going to place now 6 points along there. So that's fed in as the number of trusses, 0 to 1, so it's going to hopefully give you 6 points between 0 and 1. I'm going to feed it a list of curves. Let's go ahead and bring down that list of curves. Let me go ahead and run that. Hopefully I have 4 different curves that each have 6 different points on them. If I transpose that though, I will instead get 6 different curves, or 6 different groups that each have 4 points in them. And when I'm drawing this curve, this NURBS curve over here, all that's really doing is helping me visualize. It's really not doing anything. Well, I could use to do more than that, but that's what I'm using it for right now. It's going to draw some curves in the opposite direction. Okay. I could later, in fact, I will later go ahead and subdivide those curves into more points, because if I want more than 4 panels going high, I only have 4 points to work with right now. I might want to subdivide those curves. Okay. But I just got some curves to work with. And if you've got those curves to work with, you are ready now to go through and start placing the trusses. So the trusses, again, are 4-point trusses, the ones I'm using. Now, Dom's not going to use that because she created a lovely 4-point tube. So she can go ahead and use that part instead. Or it could be anything. It could be rounded tubes. It could be kind of square tubes. It could be most anything, any profile. You could taper if you want to. There's all sorts of things you can do. The only thing that this tube down here requires is it wants basically, where'd it go? Over here somewhere. It's 4 points. I know that because if I open the part or I select it in Revit, you can see it has 4 adaptive points. So, what I will do is come on back here. I got my family type. I'm going to go ahead and, oops, well, let's kind of put this next piece in because we can. It's coming up in 3A and 3B, but we'll just do it now because we are either incredibly optimistic and naive, or feeling very hopeful about how good our capabilities are. And I'll assume that it's in the latter for right now. It's usually somewhere between. So, I got family types, I got some curves over here. How about a little adaptive component by points? That sounds like a pretty good function. Adaptive component by points. Super. I am ready then to give it some points. I'll take those lists of points, that little group of 4. I'll take the family right over here. And we go ahead and get rid of all this fun happening in the background here, just so you can actually see if it's actually happening. I still have 1 left over. Okay, you can see my pumpkin geometry back there. Let's go ahead and give it a run. Okay, there's my 4 trusses, looking pretty good. or six stresses.
Now, before you dive on in, oh, be sure to flex things, because you want to check to see if this is all working out okay. Right now I have six of those trusses in there.
Try making it three, try making it eight, try changing that value around. You could either drag the slider or type a value in there. But hopefully the things will flex nicely. At the same time, you can try like changing the curvature a little bit. Now watch out as you change the curvature on these different the sides of my pumpkin. If you get too far up or too far out, you can get it to the point where you just can't make the part. Every once in a while you get this message, oh, cannot make that part. Revit cannot create the component. And it's just there's something about the adaptive geometry that's bending back on itself or folding in a way. It just doesn't understand how to create it. So if you ever get that and it says delete type, that's not a program problem typically with your programming. It may be that your points are sort of weird that you're feeding it, but it's more often that just your geometry is such that the component just can't be created. Okay? So we can do some of that. We can say, okay, how about over here? What do I want to do? Do you get one where you can't make it?
Yeah.
What'd you do to kind of, what'd you change its shape to?
I changed the third radius.
That's what I was about to do. How fat did you make it?
To 9.7.
Okay, that may be too narrow, because that would sort of, I think, make it sort of fold back on itself.
Past the truss.
Yeah. So, for example, what I'm going to do is a starting point where I say 37, I'm going to go ahead and make that like 45. It'll just make it really fat in the middle. Let's see how that works. But if you get this thing sort of folding back on itself, then it has troubles. Okay. So you can definitely get things a little bit out of whack. Yeah, I can move that point down a little bit too. But we'll sort of see how that goes. Now, if you have your things turned on to auto right now, chances are every time you move that little slider, you wait and wait and wait and wait. Because it takes a while for it to regenerate those parts. So, a couple ways to sort of combat that. One is to go ahead and turn on manual. Just kind of regenerate it every time independently. That's what I've been doing. There's another way to do this, though, that is actually kind of interesting. I'll see if I can get it to work. It used to work pretty well with an if statement. I haven't tried it with the latest release. But basically, I would say, you know, based on this value right here, regenerate trusses in Revit, which is a Boolean, it's either true or false, either go through and do it or not do it. So let's see if we can make this work. The way that little part works is, see how right now we feed in this little list of components right here to the adaptive component, the list of points to the adaptive component. I like to go through and actually sort of not necessarily feed you that list. Okay. And the way you can do that is by using an if function. Let's see if this is working. It used to, but I'm not guaranteeing anything, because last time I tried it, it actually didn't. We'll see. If always works like this. You give it some sort of test, so some sort of value, a Boolean true or false. And then based on true, if true, it'll feed through whatever you passed in as true. If false, it'll pass through whatever you passed in as the false side. Okay, so. Should work. Our programming brain says it kind of likes that. So let's see if we can make that work. My test is regenerate trusses in Revit. So that's either going to be true or false. The true block is what to do in case it's true. In the case it's true, what I want to do is take that list of points. Okay. What I'm going to do now is, as a result of that, though, pass the points through out of the if block. That way, okay, depending if it's true or false, it's either going to get something or not.
Now, as long as everything's true, this thing's kind of happy because it is getting a list of points. If it were not true, though, we need to sort of pass something in. So
let me just kind of, I'll test this both different ways. Let me try running it the way it is right now. And I'll put in what I used to do, see how it works. Okay, so true, it's sort of blah, blah, blah. It should be getting that list of points, but it's kind of complaining. See what it's complaining about. It is saying, warning, one or more of the input types are not matching. Couldn't find a version that takes arguments of something or other. Okay, so I got true. It should be getting true. Let me try false. Then I'm going to give up on this because I think that it may still not work the way I want it to. I'm going to go through and find, see if I can find, it used to be my ever popular list empty. Pass that as the false. And let me try writing that. Doesn't like that either in terms of what's going on. One or more.
I imagine couldn't find a conditional of type Boolean array array. Okay. But I'm not understanding the if. The if's looking a little differently than it used to work, so I'll do a little research on that in terms of what's going on there.
But when you see me with little if statements and if blocks, that's what it's all about. But it looks like it's not working right now. So for now, I'll just pass in the proper point of list of points. Kind of leave that stuff a little bit disconnected right now. I owe you an answer on the if. Because if used to work.
It's two of my friends.
Okay, so we have this thing. We're going through, putting all these different sort of trusses out there that are looking pretty good. So let me pause and reflect with you guys. You got trusses? They're all hanging out looking good? Okay, hopefully that's looking sort of similar to what you want. Okay, next up, we are going to go on back. We actually did step three, and step four was actually that building a control switch. That was that whole notion of if we have the if and applying the Boolean, we'll figure out what changed in the if statement so we can kind of go through and use that. But it used to be that I would pass through trust points if it was true, and I would pass in an empty list if it wasn't, but it's not working. Okay. Next up, we are ready to take on those risers, those different risers that are kind of hanging around down there at the bottom. Let's think about them. Because in terms of placing them in there, we do sort of want to go through and define some arcs. Okay, we're going to have, some sort of origin for this arc. We're going to start by just creating an initial arc for the initial riser. Okay. It's going to have x0, y0, and some initial height. So, you know, that's centering it in the same location. It doesn't have to be there, but we can sort of center it around the rest of the stadium. Okay. We're going to have some sort of slider in there. The slider is going to basically be the radius. And then we're going to place that arc. What I'm going to do is, again, have the origin in the center, have the radius be the slider. Start and end, I'll just have follow the same as the stadium. Doesn't have to, but if we want to have the seats match the kind of a shape of the bowl on the outside, we can do that. So if you do, go on over to step five. Let's go to step 5A. What are you not responding about? There we are. Let me zoom on in here and we'll take a look at this logic. Actually, even up top here, just to sort of fix that whole thing where the if isn't working, if you want to sort of prepare yourself, just take the list transpose, so the points, just point it right in there, taking the if out. because we know that isn't working right now. It's all right today. Okay, let's go back to my riser logic. So it's all kind of hanging around right in here. It all starts with the number of risers. Okay, we have, here's the origin, 0, 0, 5, high. We can make that a slider or something else. Point by coordinates, it's 0, 0. Let's go ahead and we want to figure out what that riser initial height is. Okay, so if we want to go through and get the very first riser, let's just pull a 5 across. Then we'll take that point and make it the center point. Okay, for the radius of this riser, the very first one, let's just get the riser initial radius and I'll pull that across. Okay, then we'll go ahead and run this. So, oh, again, it has that normal, the Z normal. But this should just be creating sort of an inner circle. You can sort of see it down in here. Okay, that is the riser initial radius, so it's about 5 off, and it's got a radius of 10. Okay, let's see if we can get that guy going, because if we get that guy going, then we can compute the others. So, we want to create a little mathematical progression. So here's the deal. Our initial radius is 10. Okay, and for all the number of risers, let's say we have 4 different sets of seats that come popping up there. The idea is we want to create a sequence. And that sequence wants to go, let's see, if we think about the height sequence, okay, it's going to start at 5, then it's going to go 6.5, then it's going to go 6.5 plus 1, so 8. And it's going to go 9.5, and we'll build up like that. But it's going to go from the riser initial height to the number, okay, number of risers and riser height will be riser initial height to riser initial height plus the number of risers minus 1 times the riser height. Okay, that sounds like a really weird way, but what I got to do is basically take 5 plus 3 times the height is really what it is. Okay, that's why I have to subtract 1 off. Okay, and then I'm going to divide that into the number of risers. So it'll go 5 to 9 by going 5, 6.5, oops, 8, 10.5, no, 9.5. Okay, so that's going to be my height sequence. In the same way, I'm going to have a sequence going in terms of the spacing out, like the arc radiuses. So it's going to start with the initial radius, which is 10. It's going to go all the way out to, if I have 4 of them going out, what I'm going to do is add the riser tread depth. So I'm going to go 10, 12, 14, 16. So I'm going to say initial radius plus the number of risers minus 1, okay, again, times the riser tread depth. Okay, that'll get us the outer, and we'll divide that by the number of risers coming in. Okay, does that sort of make sense? Okay. If that bizarre logic actually makes sense to you, let's take a look at what it looks like. Here's the riser height sequence. Did that run it? Oh, I'd have to watch it. So here's, that's going to be the heights. Go ahead and make that the tread depths. Okay, again, I'll run that. So I'm going to pair up. The first one's going to be height of 5, radius 10. Second one, 6.5, 12, 8, 14, 9.5, 16. Kind of makes sense? Excellent. Okay, feel free to play around with any of those numbers to kind of change that. Okay, if you have these fabulous kind of heights, and you have this fabulous list of radiuses,
we can pull in, as opposed to that very singular one, kind of pull those lists in.
So what I'm going to do is, for the center points, I'm going to take those heights and pull them up to the z values. So the center points are still going to be at 0, 0, but the z values are going to be kind of following these. Okay, that'll feed into the center points. For the radiuses, okay, as opposed to sort of being just the radius of 10, we're going to take this whole series of radiuses and pull them over. But if you get all that stuff together and you give it a run, cross your fingers, with any luck, you should have something that looks like this. You got a whole bunch of different like kind of arcs. And we can change that again. Oh, let's go ahead and make six of them as opposed to four of them. But now we have a whole bowl full of steps. So we have a whole bunch of arcs that are about to become a bowl full of steps. Okay. Let me check in with you. How's that feeling? Let's stop and kind of solve some questions. Yeah?
My arcs are all stacked. They're not radiated.
Ah, let's think about it. We just have to sort of think about on the treads coming in. Okay, so let's go to on the riser, on the radius. We probably just have the initial radius. Go ahead and pull out the tread sequence. So take this function here and pull that over to the radiuses. Beautiful. Now try rewriting it. Because a little while ago, I set them all to the same radius just for the first one.
Right.
Okay, and this should now give you the whole sequence.
Yeah, let's do this.
Woohoo! Okay. How are things on the left end of the room? Left end's good? Dawn. Okay. Andrew, you doing good? Excellent. Okay, if you have these fabulous arcs, you know what I'm going to do next. I'm going to put some five-pointed components along them. So I'm going to take all those arcs. I'm going to say, let's do curve point at parameter, divide them up, and then place some parts on that. So to place those, what I am going to do is say, oops. Not that. Not that. I'm operating without mouse today, which is always weird because Dynamo and a trackpad are kind of strange together, especially on the zooming. Okay. The little zone I'm going to work with is, oh, I have most of these things down here in the blue zone down here at the bottom. What I'm going to do is say, oh, adaptive component by points. Okay, that's going to be for placing it in just a second. Let's go ahead and divide it up first. Let's go ahead and say, oh, my ever popular curve by parameter. Or no, is it parameter at points? I am so bad. Parameter. Parameter at point, there it is. Okay, so let's go ahead and grab all those different curves. We're going to tell it how many different points we want, and I have five placement points just because my little riser has five. So I'll go ahead and grab that point. Super. I should hopefully now have a bunch of arcs with five different points on them. Looks like it's complaining a little. Let's see what's going on. Little null. Let's see what's happening over here. That looks like five curves. Or six curves, that's fine. And the curve parameter point, what are you complaining about? One or more of the input types are not matching. Couldn't find a version of parameter point that takes arguments of type array int. What is messing around in here? I got a list of those. They look pretty good. I got a list of that. Curve parameter point. 5 placement point. Oh, I know what's going on. I need to go ahead and make the sequence. I'm being bad. I'm just taking 5 across. I have to do 0 to 1 to make it. Yeah, count 5. Okay, 0 to 1. Pound number of points. What that does is it says it's breaking that series 0 to 1 up into that number of increments. As opposed to if you do 0 to 1 and you don't say pound number of points, what it is it'll go 0 to 1 and it'll increment by the number.
So it'll do like 0, 1, 2, or?
It would do, in this case, it would just go 0 to 1 because the 5 wouldn't fit in there. If we said 0 to 100, 5 would go 0, 5, 10, 15, 20, all the way up to 100. Okay, still not working for me, so I'm still messing up somehow. Mr. Andrew, you got a question? No. What's going on? That looks fine. That looks fine. Do I have to rebring my curves in? Sometimes I sort of pollute a function, so I'll warn you about that. Still not complaining. I'm going to remove that function and put it back in again. Let's try again. I will bring my list of curves. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm screwing up. Pardon me. I am not doing it correctly. Parameter of points, basically just doing that. I'm using a very slightly different thing. What do I want to do? That'll teach me the freewheel. Curve point at parameter. How about that? Okay, somewhere in here there's this important lesson that says, disengage mouth, engage brain instead. Okay, that's better. Take that curve, take that list of parameters. Now we'll go ahead and run it. Okay, this should look like a whole series. Oh, I have to do a little cross product action to get them to go all across everything, all four of the curves. There, I can finally see them happening and back over there. So you see, finally, 6 different curves with 5 different points on them. We are now able to go through and take those points, take my adaptive component right here, and bring them together. Zoom on out there a little. Okay. Now I have something that doesn't look too awfully bad. You might notice, however, that, the little seats aren't quite right just yet because the little seats, the size of the adaptive component that's coming in doesn't quite match kind of what's happening right here. So for example, these guys right now, the parameters that they came in with currently have, take a look at their parameters. They got a height of 1.5 and they have a tread depth of 3. Now our tread depth's a little smaller. Our tread depth's only 2. Okay, so we could go ahead and change it over here, but that's not really how we want to do it. It'd be better to go ahead and change it in our Dynamo script so that our slider, which was dictating this geometry, is also changing that parameter for us. Okay. So, we're going to add one more function to this. Actually, we should really do 2. And to do that, let's go ahead and open up it's under step 8. Under step 8, what we're going to do is
not only place the components, but we're gonna set the parameters. So we're gonna set a parameter, the name tread depth, and we're gonna go through and pull over the tread depth from the slider. Same thing for the tread height. That way, those parameters are always matched with the slider values are. Yes?
Why can't we just change, like, to the read on the slider?
Oh, it'll, if as we change the slider, oh, well that would work.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're fixing your geometry international. Yeah, it, ultimately we want to get the 2 and 6.
Okay.
Okay, so, and that's what this other function's all about. So, let's even get up, we'll just sort of show you, well, I'll just build it right in here. Because, no, that would work too. But we got these adaptive components, so here's what we're going to do. We are going to go through and say element set parameter by name. You might remember that old function. We're going to pass in all those adaptive components. Actually, it's interesting for this, since it is actually a type parameter. Well, I think it'll work either way. Let's try pulling it in as that. I think that'll actually work. Although I think we could actually just do it to the whole family type. But let's see if it'll work this way. The parameter name is tread depth. And for the value, let's go ahead and grab that value right over here and pull that across. Okay, cross your fingers and see. Since this is a type parameter versus an instance parameter, I'm sort of debating in my own brain whether it's going to work for by giving it the individual components or whether we're going to give it the family. It could work either way. Well, then Dominique knows that instead we're going to go ahead and grab the family and pull that over. Okay, because, what's that? It's because over in Revit, this parameter that we're going after, it's not an instance parameter, it's a type parameter. So we don't actually think about it as changing the instance, we think about it as changing the whole family. So they're all going to have that same value. So let's come back over here. Let's try giving that a run. Let's see what we got. Ooh, those are slick looking. So,
you basically are always defining geometry, then you're adjusting the parameters to sort of match the geometry. But to your question, and it's a good question, seriously, it's this whole thing about you got to decide which side of the equation is driving, and if you let the geometry and the math drive, then try to like always kind of pull it that way. It's a good question. Okay. So, let's pause there for a second. How's that feeling? You got it working? You sort of, more importantly, you sort of understand it. Yes. Go ahead, what you got?
I have a tread that crosses diagonally. Is that just one, not all of them.
Really?
And
show me what it does.
Marion,
I'm coming through. I'm curious.
It's on
my mind,
but it's on a
Yeah.
So it looks like it just applied one point.
When you created the points, go ahead and change the cross product. What you have is this funny pairing of it's one from each row. So when you're creating all the points, okay. Dom is looking good. You're looking good. Fantastic. Check it out. Star performance. Looking good. Okay. So, okay, again, the problem there was having was we were sort of getting just like a single point on each row. That usually means that we're not getting the cross product. We just have shortest or longest. It was getting an X and a Y and or an arc and a point along the arc on each of those. Okay. The last part of this whole thing is panelizing. And in terms of panelizing, there's really
just a couple of steps in there, and we'll sort of do them together in terms of how we place them. We have basically some arcs going around. We have some ribs coming up and down. We're just going to start dividing those into just basically a series of X, Y, or UV grids. We're going to somehow make a grid out of that pattern. And what we're going to do here is really decide on a number of panels from top to bottom. And then we can decide for the panels that go around, do we want sort of one panel for every truss width, or do you want to have a separate number of panels for every truss width? Because you could have two or three panels. If you only had ribs, at every 45 degrees, you might want to follow the curve more closely with your panels, even though the trusses are happening at a lesser frequency. So where all that lives in my example is kind of in steps 9 and 10, but let's go ahead and just kind of give you the overview of what's going on. We're basically going to figure out how many panel rows, that is, you know, from top to bottom, how many going up the top, okay? And we're going to say, great, based on that, we're going to get those rib curves and divide them so that we have intermediate points. Then we're going to figure out really how many different panels we want going around, and based on how it all goes around and the number of panels that we want on that total distance, we'll break up those curves and sort of point curve points going around the shape, and ultimately just go through and visualize that. But let's see. I think I actually might have even done it a little bit differently in the example, but let's see if you can open up, please. Try opening up 10A. We'll just look at all the logic for this. Because the order is not really important. I originally said I was going to do it kind of up first and subdivide it, but I think in this script I actually sort of did it around the side and subdivided it that way. But we can go either way. Actually, open up 9A instead. I think 9A has the color coding. I'm sorry. Here's the deal. As we're working on these, even just so that it doesn't mess up a little bit later, I'm going to take out these little ifs. There's a couple little ifs that are kind of floating around in here. I'm going to take out the if right there, and I'm going to take out the if right there. So in both of these pink ones down here, just because I know that this aren't working, go ahead and just grab from the riser placement points, drag it directly into adaptive. And same thing over here for the trusses. I can drag that in, just taking out these ifs. So, goodbye to you, Mr. If. Save that away. Okay, in terms of thinking about these panels, let's take a look at that. Here's the way the basic logic works. I can go through and create some vertical curves at the panel seam. So let's kind of think about this. If I have these different curves, these curves that are spinning all the way around,
and I want to divide them up into a whole series of different vertical curves that would be panel seams. So if I have, you know, even though I have like five trusses or something like that, if I want to have 20 panels going around, what I'm going to do is take basically the number of panels, which is right here. There's these two sliders, one's 10 and one's 5. I have 10 sort of columns of panels and 5 rows of panels coming up. Okay? But I'm going to say, let's create some vertical curves, okay, for the seams. I'm going to say, great, it's going to go from 0 to 1 and give me 10. Actually, it's going to be a little bit different. What it's going to do is, if I actually want to have 10 panels, what I actually need is 11 points, just because I need 11 seams to make 10 panels between. Okay. So that's why it's number of panel columns plus 1. So if I run this, this will give me a whole series of values from 0 to 1. Let's let that run. Take a look over here. That's giving me a whole series of values, 0, 0.1, 0.2, all the way down to 1. That is true, actually. 11 happens to work out very nicely. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is take the curves and divide them by those points. I'm gonna take those points and the curves that I wanna subdivide are actually all these radius curves, all these arcs that are down there. So go ahead and pull them up. So if I take those same arcs up to here, and I divide it by those points, you'll see what's going to happen is, on the little pumpkin in the background, let me zoom on out a little bit, I now have a lot of points, the number of points that are going to be the seams between the panels, kind of on the shape in the background. So super. I'll start with that. I divide it into all those different points, so on each of those I now have that number of points. What I'm going to do is transpose it so I can group them into columns, so we'll actually sort of be able to see the vertical seams. So that's what transpose is all around. And then finally, I'm going to draw a NURBS curve there. Again, this is just a curve to kind of connect them all together. Okay, so now you can see either, I can't see it there so well. Okay, so I now have a whole bunch of curves. So taking those initial curves, dividing it up into tens, I now have 11 different seams kind of coming up and down. Sort of make sense? Okay, if you've got 11 different seams coming up and down, and you want to divide each of them into kind of 5 rows coming across, so it'd be 10 by 5, I'm going to take those curves and divide them by a series that goes 0 to 1 with 5 breaks. So I'm going to take those curves and subdivide them in the other direction. So grab those NURBS curves. Take that across there. And when I pull that together, okay, now I have the points going up and down in the vertical direction. So with this, I've got a nice grid of points, points that are coming all the way around here and then coming down. I could have done it the other way. I could have sort of divided it up this way. I could have taken my panel ribs and divided it by 5 and subdivided it. It's really whatever way you sort of think is going to be an easier way to define your geometry. Okay. But now, as you look at the difference and you spy those little groups of things that almost look like little quads of points in the background, you are ready to do some operating on them. And what you're ready to do is, if you go ahead and open up the very last one in here, say, you want to save changes? Say no. Come back out to 11.
We are going to take those. We are going to take that list of points right here. We might have to do a little flattening on it, but we're going to break it into quads and then use that to place adaptive components. Okay, so in that same sense, I'll ignore all that if stuff. I'm going to take all those different points out there. I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to kill off those other ifs that are hanging around bothering me just because they're not working right now. I don't want them to mess up your scripts. Okay, those ifs are gone. Come back up to the top here. I will go through and run this. Let's make sure if my curve points at parameters are looking right here. Okay, let's see what that looks like. That looks like a list of lists. I think it's in the right order in terms of what's going on. I don't think I have to flatten that, but we'll see if we need to in just a minute. We're going to go ahead and take that point over to the point list. Because it sort of looks like a grid right now, which is, I think, what it wants. We're going to take the quad points that come out of it and flatten that, just because as we go through and create these like a list of quads, we actually sort of don't want them in rows and columns. We just want them to be kind of a single list of 4 points. I got Fagel's list of all these 4 points. If I got all these 4 points, blah, 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 we're ready to take that over to the adaptive component. And finally, we can put our panels on by joining that. Okay, and we will stop there for today. Because that's really, I think, where most of you are going to get to in your project. So take the geometry, subdivide the geometry, and then pull it out in a couple directions, one being whatever direction for placing adaptive components that are multi-point adaptive components, for example, trusses or grids or something like that. Then sort of figure out if you're going to panelize the surface, how you can apply panels to the surface. And we end up with something kind of like a spider's nest out there. But we'll look at something that's panelized. Now, just so you have a sense of what's going on, given the degree of curvature of this, you'll notice my 5 points that I'm using to define the panels aren't really following the curve very well. What that's telling me is I may need to put more panels in so I have more curvature so that I can really kind of approximate that shape a little bit better. That's all that's going on there. So you can try just changing the number of panel rows and get things, because you know, whenever you're approximating curve with straight segments, either it does or doesn't fit very well. So that's what's going on there. Okay. Let us adjourn for today. We're going to be sticking around answering some questions on some individual projects now, and we'll probably have a lot of office hours again tomorrow. I'll post that. So if you're having struggles with your project and you want some guidance and stuff like that, be looking for that. And I don't know, just get yourself ready, but hopefully have some fun with it and just create your first initial parametric design creation. We'll talk about how to kind of customize it some more next time.